All right, here we go. All right, simple harmonic motion. Is there a pencil that went with that? No, but. All right, simple harmonic motion. You saw this video last year. Okay, so you got a spring. Okay, it's oscillating up and down about this equilibrium point. Okay, we're likening it to uniform circular motion, and we're like, hey, look at that.
Three dimensions. That was the same thing, except the voice was crazy.
Okay, good with that. And then we're looking at a pendulum as it goes back and forth. We're looking at the shadow.
Getting pretty close.
Yeah, no.
The pendulum motion, the shadow of the rotating object, are almost lined up now.
Okay, so. This is a good thing to put in your notes. Simple harmonic motion happens when the restoring force is equal to or is proportional to x to the first. Okay? Not x squared. Not the square root of x. Yeah. Great question. The restoring force is the force that brings it back to its original shape or length, original position. Okay? So it's proportional to x to the first. Okay? And x is the displacement from your equilibrium point. So here is your unstretched length on your spring. As this stretches, in this case, the restoring force is the spring force, and that's equal to negative kx. Okay, so as this stretches, your x is going this way, your restoring force is going in the opposite way that your displacement is. And then it's over here. Your displacement is being squished, compressed. Your displacement is this way. Your force, your restoring force, is in the opposite direction that which way you're being displaced, and it's increasing proportional to how far you're being stretched or compressed from this equilibrium position. This is what makes it simple harmonic motion. Okay? It could still be harmonic, but it's not going to be simple if it doesn't follow that, okay? Which is definitely in the realm of possibilities in this class.
No.
Okay, does that make sense? Okay. All right, so last year we built these around circular motion, but then once we learned calculus, haven't got there yet.
We're almost there, guys.
We took the derivative. Produce the, like, from position, velocity, time, okay? And so a lot of times you're going to start with, you don't have to do it this way, but it's traditional to start displacement as a cosine graph because you're displacing your object. You start with your object displaced a certain amount, usually at rest, and then let go. Don't have to do that. You could like start from rest and like hit it. But traditionally, you're starting from rest at some maximum amplitude, let it go. And so you get a cosine graph here, a negative sine graph here, and a negative cosine graph here. Okay. The amplitude being A for this is your displacement from your equilibrium position. Here, this is your maximum speed, which is equal to your angular frequency times your amplitude. So this expression here, the maximum this could be is 1. So your maximum speed would be equal to your amplitude times your angular frequency, which has connections with rotational motion. Well, we would say rotational speed times the radius gives you your speed. Okay. This expression is angular frequency that now I think, yep, next slide will talk about it. And then maximum acceleration is your amplitude times your angular frequency squared. This has connections with centripetal acceleration, where you have speed squared over the radius. Speed being, this is the one that I tend to memorize, speed squared over the radius, which has connections to this one. So you have rotational speed times the radius squared over the radius, and you end up with omega squared times the radius, which okay, just to bridge those gaps there. Okay, so a hallmark of simple harmonic motion is your acceleration as a function of time is equal to negative omega squared times position as a function of time. So it's negative, you have a cosine graph, okay? And this comes out a lot at the maximum. So the A max is equal to, and they usually just do the amplitude. Right. Okay. This, it's not on the equation sheet, but this is really popular on the multiple choice section. Okay. Good with that. So angular frequency, it's the rate at which the cycle is completed. It is in radians per second. So another way to express that is cycles per second. No. We're going to stick with radians. Radians per second. Okay. So that's equal to how quickly you go through 2 pi. So rather than thinking 2 pi on a circle, think 2 pi on a sine graph. Okay. The rate at which this happens. So period is the inverse of frequency. So you get 2 pi f. I think this is on the equation sheet.
Definitely 2 pi over 2.
Okay. So this is given on the equation sheet. Mm-hmm. And you remember that frequency is 1 over the period. Okay. Oh, well, look at that. Nice. So you don't have to memorize any of that. But being using it would be helpful. So this sometimes is how you'll use that. So instead of omega, like, well, you can dance between those. Okay. Good with that? All right. So this, I bring this up because this comes out on multiple choice. I would not necessarily put this in. This seems more math class than it does physics class, but you see this probably a third of the time on multiple choice. So I'm like, it's pretty good. It's worth throwing some stuff at it. So back to pre-cal. Okay. So unit circle. Okay. So your X component of this vector with theta being this angle here, the R cosine, Y being this vector here. Here's your X, here's your Y. So sine of that. Okay. And so we're going to assume that, why do I want phi to be equal to 0?
Yes.
So this phi thing is our phase angle. Is that the correct terminology math class wise? That's your starting. Oh, no, they don't teach it anymore. Phase angle.
Let's go.
Okay.
It's
your initial angle. So if this would cause your your parabola to slide back and forth. Not parabola. Thank you. Your sine or cosine. Did you guys do that? What do you call it?
Phase
shift.
Phase shift.
Yeah, they give us this equation, but in all practical purposes, I've not seen this come up on an AP test yet. Okay. So we're going to assume that our initial phase angle is 0. Okay. So in general, this would be equal to this, like rotational speed, the rate at which your angular displacement is changing. And this is final minus initial. Final clock reading minus initial clock reading. We're going to assume that's 0. We're going to assume this is 0. And we get this. They do this a lot in math. Just straight up. They don't do this delta thing because they assume things start at 0. Okay. So bringing this over here, theta is equal to the rotational speed multiplied by the time. Okay. And then we have our equation or mathematical equation for a circle. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we're substituting this in for here. That in for here. This becomes r squared times cosine squared plus r squared plus sine squared equals r squared, divide by r squared, get cosine squared plus sine squared equals 1. So that is just out there so that you can answer a multiple choice, one more multiple choice question. Okay.
On the AP 1 test.
They didn't have that on the AP 1 test. Pretty confident.
You didn't smile, are you cheating?
Actually, you know, the question might have been published by now.
Yeah.
Plus, it's not cheating if you never actually tells anyone the answers. What a question.
I gave Smiley my tablet.
You didn't know.
Correct answer is 2. Okay, that's just factoid.
Yeah, 1 doesn't work.
Okay, it has to be negative because the force has to be in the opposite direction of displacement. Okay, it always wants it bringing it back to 0. All right, so you did this last year. Okay, so we said spring force is equal to mass times acceleration. Okay, it's the only thing in the x direction. There is normal force and gravity, but I just care about the horizontal direction for this example. Correct. Okay, so spring force with Hooke's law. Okay, it's equal to negative kx, it's equal to mass times acceleration. So we can solve for acceleration. Now, they're going to ask, and this throws a lot of kids if they haven't been exposed to it, but this is super easy. On the AP test, they say write the differential of position in terms of time for this motion. And kids are like, whoa. This is super easy. Acceleration is equal to double derivative. Is that what?
Second derivative.
Thank you. The second derivative of time. So just writing this. Just substituting this in for acceleration, full points. That is it. That is all you have to do. That is it. Don't do any further. Done. 2 points in the bag, running on. Okay.
I would think that since it's the differential of position, I think you'd want to multiply that dt squared to the you'd want to move the dt squared over.
The rubric is okay with you leaving it like that.
Let's go.
Okay.
Don't even have to remember how to multiply.
Okay. Okay. Is everybody good with that? That is all you do. Okay. Now, so that's just me coaching you how to do well on the AP test. And there's progression. Okay. So spring force equal mass times acceleration. Now, this is, you're going to have to be able to reproduce this. Okay. So acceleration for simple harmonic motion is equal to negative omega squared x. Yeah. Okay. Good with that? I'm dropping off as a function of time because that just gets convoluted. But it is. Okay.
And the other x is also a function of time, so.
Correct.
Divided out.
Yep. So I'm dropping this in here. Okay. this, negatives go away, x's go away. Okay, so we get spring constant over the mass of the oscillating object is equal to angular frequency squared. Solve for that, square root. Period, or 2 pi over the period is equal to your angular frequency. Substituting that, you get this. This is on the equation sheet. You'll be good. This will carry you through the multiple choice. This will not carry you through the free response. Understanding of what happened here, that will carry you through a free response. Okay, good with that. I might come back to that. I don't know. I should look to my slides. All right. Questions there? This is where people usually get derailed, because that's not on the equation sheet. Okay. This right here, most people can come up with this really easily. Okay. It's going from here to here that people get derailed. Okay. Good with that.
It is W.
It's currently W.
Sam, you look like you just came out of the
window. I did the contest.
Okay.
Okay. Like, girls, that's like part two. Yeah.
Bro, I'm gonna get a double discount. I guarantee.
I didn't use that until like.
I used it
to like,
there's a couple.
All right, here we go. Yeah. Okay, restoring force is linearly proportional to displacement from the equilibrium position. What am I trying to say here? Okay, so, yep. So, force is equal to some coefficient. Doesn't matter. Negative displacement. Okay, so there's something. Acceleration has the same dependency. It's just a different coefficient.
Unless the mass is one.
True.
Well, then we've been misled.
What? How have we been misled?
No. That's not a mass. That's not a mass.
No, I was making a joke. All
right, okay.
Force equals mass times acceleration.
Okay, so looking at your second derivative, accelerate, like falling from this, is equal to some coefficient negative times some coefficient x. Okay, so this was like the hallmark thing here. So whatever this coefficient is, that's going to be equal to your angular frequency squared. So if you know your angular frequency, square that, that's going to give you your coefficient, which oftentimes they give you the coefficient. They say, here's your acceleration. If you take the square root of that, that's your angular frequency. And then you can use that to figure out your period. So I'm trying, like, this is kind of like, I won't say shortcuts, but like, just like how you answer a multiple choice question quickly. Micah.
So basically, no acceleration.
Yes.
Is that how it's used?
What?
That's been used all the
time. Mm-hmm. Yep, this one right here. You had that last year, but I don't know if that percolated to your like long-term memory. But this is definitely, like, flag this on your notes when you're like studying for the APC test. This is worth being in your mental memory, your short-term memory, but like right before the AP, that's worth, that is, this one's definitely worth, like, parallel axis theorem, but this comes up more often than parallel axis theorem. Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay. So vertical springs. I'm like, wow, look at the pretty picture. Okay. So vertical springs has the same math as a horizontal spring. Okay. And here's the proof of that. So watch this. Like, please make note. You have a spring, relaxed length. Then you take mass and you suspend it from that. And this is not the equilibrium position. Yeah. This is. Okay? It's when it's at rest. Okay? That's not the equilibrium position. This is. That's the only difference between a horizontal spring and a vertical spring.
Oh, okay.
Okay? Everybody good with that? Horizontal spring, that's your equilibrium. This is your equilibrium position. So at that point, we know spring force is equal to the force of gravity, and we can get this expression here, which is often how you're going to find the spring constant. Okay. Now, if we move that, we're going to call this distance here x naught. Okay. We're going to take that and we're going to move that beyond x naught. And we're going to let it go, and it's going to oscillate about this equilibrium position. Okay? My argument is that this behaves just like this in terms of the frequency and all that stuff. And here's the proof. So you have a spring force time, or minus force of gravity. Like, if you do a free body diagram of this thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yep. Good call. Good call. Okay. Free body diagram. It's not equal to zero. It's equal to zero right here at the equilibrium position. We're stretching it beyond that. So x naught plus x. And then it's equal to mass, or minus force gravity is equal to mass times acceleration. We're distributing the negative kx, and then we've got where my kx go, my x, oh no, right over here. Yeah, so right here I can plug mass times acceleration of gravity in for that guy. And this cancels with this.
Yeah.
And we get that. So same motion. So don't get tripped up because it's vertical. In terms of the period is identical. The angular frequency is identical.
Again, assuming equal mass and displacement. Actually, it's a spring constant, not displacement.
Correct.
I said the wrong one.
Okay. Now, energies change, but the frequency at which this happens is identical. Okay. So, what AP loves to do is to throw at you different scenarios which you haven't necessarily seen before. So one of my jobs is to expose you to as many some harmonic motion things as I can. One of which is a torsion pendulum. And the torsion pendulum,
a stiff piece of spring wire.
So what we're doing is we're rotating this, we'll call it a cable, and it doesn't like to get rotated because it's, and then it's like, okay, does that make sense? That's the simple harmonic motion part of it. So the restoring force is this torque, this twist of the cable itself. Okay, that makes sense? It's a torsion pendulum. So, torque is linearly proportionate to theta. Okay, this is still simple harmonic motion. Okay, it's just in a rotational point of view. Okay, so we're rotating it by some angle theta and letting it go. So what we can do is this. So we know that torque is equal to I alpha. The I is the moment of inertia of the disk. Okay. So we can substitute in here kappa times theta is equal to I. So just like we have acceleration is equal to negative omega squared x, we can say that rotational acceleration is equal to negative omega squared theta. So we can substitute this in.
Don't put the minus there.
What?
Because then it looks like I might.
Is that better?
You put the minus in front. But...
Okay. You see what I did there? Now, negatives go away, thetas go away. So you're left with kappa over moment of inertia equals omega squared. So the square root of kappa over moment of inertia is equal to angular frequency. And period, therefore, is equal to 2 pi over moment of inertia times kappa.
Kappa is just a constant, right?
Correct. Kappa is just a constant. Saying how stiff the wire is. It's like the spring constant. Okay. I don't know how your brain works conceptually. My brain goes here before it goes to here. But either way you do it, conceptually own that. Like digest that. Is like, does that make sense? If I increase the kappa, how stiff that spring is, that's gonna cause this process to happen faster. That's gonna cause this process, as this increases, to have a smaller period. The time it takes for one complete cycle is smaller. So I don't know how your brain works. Mine tends to go this way. Okay. As the moment of inertia increases, that's like me holding the bowling ball and doing this, like this is like, as quickly. Increase the period, decreases the angular frequency.
What do you have on that bowling ball?
More mass far away from the axis of rotation.
What do you have on that bowling ball?
Eye bolt with a, not a carabiner, but some kind of D clip, D ring.
Is that legal for bowling?
Okay.
Yeah,
all right.
I want to know how that what impacts the number of the average number of pins from my collection of shots that get at least one pin.
All right. So a physical pendulum. This is not a point mass. Just anything that's not a point mass that's a pendulum. It's known as a physical pendulum. Okay. So torque is linearly proportionate to this. So like okay, so here is, you got this object, and we're going to say that, sorry, this orange object looks like a nose. We're going to say the center of mass is right here. Okay? So the extended free body diagram, you've got gravity here. Okay? And it's just oscillating about this point here. Okay, there are some forces up here, but the torque from this is equal to this component. Like if we make this our origin, actually, I don't want to make that. I'll make this when I tilt my axis like this. The part that's perpendicular to this radius. That's what's doing the torque. Okay. That's your like force of gravity in the x direction, we'll call it. Okay. To find that, here's theta. Here's theta. I want this part, so I'm going to use sine. You could also use it in terms of distance. Is everybody okay with the fact that we're using sine? Okay. And then times the lever arm. Now, so right, give this a shot. What is the differential of the angular position in terms of time for this motion? Give this one a shot. Just kind of throwing you in the 5 foot deep pool here. Mm-hmm. So if you have this, what you're trying to think about is setting up equal to alpha. Because once you have alpha, then you know this is the second derivative. Okay, that's all you have to do. You're not gonna die. Don't freak out. Just stand up. And your head will be above water. Okay? You can drown in 5 feet of water. Easy. But you shouldn't.
Pretty short ways. I don't know.
I can drown in 5 feet of water. I can also drown in 5 foot of water. I
That's also insulting.
All right. So you're just going to go I alpha.
Okay, fine.
Okay, that's it. Now, to make that a little bit better, let me introduce to you a small angle approximation. It's Isaac's favorite. So when theta is small, sine theta, this is in radians, sine theta is really close to just theta.
Let's go for a cubic approximation. That's a bit better.
Okay. So you can write this like this. And in your explanation, you say using small angle approximation. Okay. It is on the rubric. Using small angle approximation, you know this is this. It is so this becomes, this makes the, what this does is it makes torque linearly proportionate to theta. Rather than writing it like this. Okay? Do you see how we're going for this? This is what we want for simple harmonic motion. Okay? When you want this to go away. Think anytime you want to do simple harmonic motion. That's really where it's going to come. In this, no. If you're in radians, now the more popular question is how small is small.
That's true.
Okay.
What about the Planck?
It works pretty well. I'd say don't go beyond 30 degrees. But But anywhere closer to that's getting better and better. The closer you are to zero, the better this approximation works.
So there are limitations. It can't be greater angle than 30 degrees.
Right. You just say, no, here's your explanation. You displace it by a small angle. Boom, 100%. No one's going to question, like, well, how small is small? That's the rubric says all you're looking for. You're not. They would fire him. Like, who cares? Just like, get the job done. No, I did not say that at all.
You would just get fired.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So, find an expression for the period. Go. Look back at your notes. Look back at your notes.
Oh, genius. Smile there. How's this? The period in line. Oh, wait, no, that's not. Oh, we got it. Your equation for period. Genius. I have a
question.
This looks like a T, but it's in the I and I just left out the fraction bar.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, cool.
Send note
What am I looking for?
Me and Matt got on time. There were John Diggers that looked like.
Okay, 34 and 54. Let this one add up to the number of days of school we passed. We have not had 88. Have we had 88?
Okay, how are we doing?
I'm doing awesome.
Have we had 88 in school?
Yeah, we're over in Boston. We're over the 90s.
No, we're
not.
I highly doubt.
There's less days in this
yes.
Oh, semester. Correct. 45 is an
important. I have a countdown on my computer. How many days of school
we have? Yo,
I started on day one.
All right.
I forget what school.
114 more than I did.
That's more than a third. That's more than a third.
All right, here we go. So, hopefully you did this. We want small or small angle approximation. I'll start it from the beginning here.
Impressive. I don't think I can pull that off. Impressive.
Not even Daniel's
angle. Okay, so I went from here to here. Small angle approximation. Okay. And it is. It's going to be negative.
Yeah.
It's going to be negative.
I did probably tell her at some point that it would be funny.
Okay. Right here, you're doing I alpha. And then here, you're saying alpha is equal to negative omega squared theta.
Oh, the D theta was messing with me.
Yeah, I know. I was like, I know. I'm sorry.
Just the last one got me.
Wait, why is it negative?
Because the torque is in the opposite direction of the displacement. You okay with that? Like, that's just a condition for simple harmonic motion. Any type of.
Also, time can't really be negative. So, if we solve this.
Okay,
the period is not going to be
positive.
Negative.
Not,
and you get a negative answer.
So you get mgd over I square root. So period is equal to 2 pi. Nope. Square root of I, or the quantity I over mgd. How did you do?
So back before I had the misfortune of meeting these for the first time, my mother would come home to the dinner table and say,
"This kid,
what period did you
meet?" I was in first period.
I was quiet.
Period, that's right.
Like
yeah, you sure did.
Okay. So, looking at this, does this make sense? As the moment of inertia increases, it's gonna oscillate less frequently. It's gonna take a greater the period is gonna be greater. Okay. As the mass increases, surprisingly, that's gonna. But if you like had an expression for this, it would cancel. Okay. And then distance as the distance of the center of mass increases,
also kind of changes I as well, so we're just going to hold ice.
Okay. Now, here. Oh! Boo! So close to the punchline.
I didn't say.